2 over 2 1 equals 2 over 2 1. Gamma minus 1 over gamma. All of that is right. Here, this plug in the wrong opposite values. P2 is 100, and Q1 is 500. I had it the opposite, but the actual calculation is right. It's just a big typo. Okay, so let's start. Last thing we're talking about was the speed of sound. The speed of sound in different mediums. The speed of sound in air, solids, and liquids. So we have example 2.2. And this example is going to show how the speed of sound changes in air, water, and a solid. So what we want to look for is A is a gas. This takes the gas, it's going to be air. Then also we want to find a liquid. The liquid we're going to use would be water. And a solid. And the solid in this case is going to be a metal, we're going to use copper. And we want to find the speed of sound in all of them at a temperature of 27 degrees Celsius or 300 Kelvin. So now we're going to compare them and see how it differentiates. So for air, now we know air is going to be our gas. And basically what we're going to be dealing with in this class, A is gamma RT. So we're going to derive that equation. We're going to use that equation a lot. We're just plugging our values. Gamma is 1.4 for air, 287 and 300. And that will be around 347.19 liters per second. So now let's go to water. For water, we're going to have to use a different equation. This equation in particular is only for ideal gases, so don't get it confused with something else. For water, we use a couple of properties. The density of water is about 1,000 kilograms per meter cube. And the compressibility constant is 0.51 times 10 to the negative 6 kilopascal. And this is the isothermal compressibility constant. I mean, the isentropic compressibility constant in here. No, actually this isothermal, so that's a T. Now, in terms of the isothermal, the equation that we used in here was gamma 1 rho T. Now we don't have a gamma for air. For gamma we know is the ratio of specific heats. So for water, Cp is very close to Cv, so for constant pressure and constant volume, it's very close to each other. So as a result, gamma can be equal to 1. And then we just substitute the values in here. What we have to be careful is using the right units. So we have the density is 1,000 kilograms per second, kilograms per meter cubed. And the Ks, or Kt, I mean the isothermal compressibility constant, is 0.51 times 10 to the negative 6 over kilopascals. Now, when it comes to units, if we want to have units in meters per second, we need this to be in pascals. So in order to do that, we're just going to multiply by 1,000 pascals in 1 kilopascal. That way these two will cancel out and we can have the right units that we need. And that will be 1400 meters per second. So as we see already going from air to water, the speed of sound is much faster than water. And the last one that we're going to look for will be copper. Now copper is a solid. So we have a density of 8900 kilogram per meter cube. And for solids, we don't use compressibility constants, we use bulk modulus. The bulk modulus for copper, for isentropic flow, would be 1.218 times 10 to the 8 kilopascals. So once again, we're going to use the right equation here. And this is the one that includes the bulk modulus in it. And that is bulk modulus over density. So we just divide each quantity. So once again, here's something to watch out will be the units. using field pass calls. In order to be able to get meters per second, we have to make sure that we have pass calls inside. So we just, once again, multiply by 1,000. And this will be equal to 3,700. So as we see, the speed of sound increases when we go from a less more compressible media to a less compressible media. So basically, we can conclude, the conclusion that we're going to make is that the less compressible, which basically is more compressible, will be a gas, less compressible will be a solid, then the larger the velocity or the speed of sound. And what does that happen? That has to do with the incompressibility, which has to do with the density. The less compressible, the more compressible means the more changes in density. In a solid, we can assume that density is constant. When in a gas, the density is not constant. And when that happens, the fluid has to modify itself. And by being a constant, the fluid all moves instantaneously. And by moving instantaneously, it makes it move faster at speed of sound. Any questions about these equations? Now remember, if for some reason you have a question of this sort, these parameters might be given to you, or if you want to look for them, they're in the tables in the back of the book for different subsets. So now that we know the speed of sound, how that works, now we can treat this about supersonic and subsonics and supersonic flows, incompressible flows. So that would be section 2.4, that is subsonic and supersonic flows. Now in order to analyze these flows and see what happens, remember, this chapter is about how the wave sounds and how the wave propagates across a medium. So we have to understand how this works that way. So let's imagine that we have a stationary fluid. And in that stationary fluid, we're just gonna put like a point projectile that is moving at a certain velocity. So we're gonna put a point projectile. It's injected into the fluid. And it's gonna have velocity. It's going to be moving to the right. So this is stationary. We put the front projectile, and this is going to be moving to the right with velocity v. And at particular time intervals, at one time interval, so 0, 1, 2, 3, it's going to be moving in different distances. So the distance between 0 and 1 would just be that velocity times delta v. In between 1 and 2, here will be 2v delta v. So basically, that distance would just be a number n, whichever interval that we want to deal with, times the velocity times delta t. So this is just the distance that is moving. Now for a wave, the wave is emitting, but this is the front projectile, this is emitting some wave, and the wave moves at the speed of sound. So the distance of wave, so this is the distance of the particle that's being injected, and the distance of the wave is just changing that velocity to the speed of sound. So that would be an A delta t. Now here, don't confuse A with acceleration. The A that we're using in this particular chapter is just the V, which is the velocity at the speed of sound. So let's start comparing this, how we change V, how that would affect everything. So the first thing that we can do is just assume that velocity is zero. So basically this projectile, it just staying stationary. But by staying stationary, it's still emitting waves. So how does that work? So we start here. And these waves are being emitted. They're going to emit it in all directions. So in 3D, it's emitting everywhere around it. So we have here, at one time interval, it's going to emit a wave. It's going to go around that way. So this here, this wave. So this is not how the particle moves, but how the wave that the particle is emitting outside. And this wave is moving at the speed of sound. So here we have A delta. After another time interval, this wave is going to grow, and this wave is going to move, and this wave is going to go into 2a delta t. And then it's going to keep on growing and growing and growing, and there's going to be but the point is still emitting waves. Now this waves, this is just going to be emitted, compressible wave. Or also, these waves, which are moving at the speed of sound, sometimes they're referred to as pressure waves. And these are the waves that are helping the flow communicate with it to know what's going to happen or what's going to do as we go along. So this is just a stationary that will happen to the point particle. Now what happens if we start moving? So once we start moving, we can either move supersonic, subsonic, or just sonic. So let's first move this particle at a speed that is lower than the speed of sound. So for subsonic, that velocity will be less than A. So once again, we start with a particle zero. And this particle is going to travel 1, 2, 3. And it's moving at a speed V. Now after 3 times interval, so we have 0, 1, 2, 3. When the particle was here, it had been emitting waves already for like 3 times. So it emitted wave this way, that way, and eventually a bigger one here. So we're just gonna do the last one, which is gonna be the one that 3 is gonna see. So this will be 3A delta T. Because at time 0, when we're at 3, we're already moving 3 through waves. Now time 3, in the first wave, we're moving 2 waves. So it will be slightly smaller wave. But the center of this one is at 1. So this one will be 2A delta T. And then 2 is going to do the same thing here. So it's smaller, but it's going to be on 2. This will be A delta T. And we just arrived at 3, so 3 hasn't emitted any waves. Really what this drawing is trying to show is that at time 3, 3 has already been communicated by 1 or by 0, 1 or 2, what's happening to the flow. And by doing that, we can let the flow move smoothly without having to worry, because 3 already knows what happened before. So basically, what we have here is that 3 is able to sense emotion from the beginning. So 3 already knows that the particle is moving up V, and it doesn't really have to do anything, so it can modify accordingly. So if there were to be a body or a blunt body of any sort of airfoil, a wedge or anything in here, the flow knows with enough time to modify its streamline so it doesn't crash against it. And this is just basically because it's inside the wave. So as a result, the fluid adjusts as pressure wave moves farther from the initial location. So pressure wave moves farther ahead of the projectile itself. So the projectile is always behind the pressure wave. And by doing that, then the fluid can adjust accordingly. What's going to happen with supersonic, this is going to be outside this, and that's where the problem is going to happen. So that will be subsonic. In order to go to supersonic, let's just first do sonic. And in this case, our velocity is exactly the speed of sound. Here we have a little space between the waves. My drawing is not to scale, but there's space between them. So there's a lot of time to get ready and prepare for what's happening next. Now we're going to have the same thing going on. So we have the velocity. But this time, as we go along, we have one wave here. They're all going to be colliding at a particular value here, so as it reaches the value. So at point 3, so we have 1, 2, and 3. And this time, all of these waves are going to crash at the same value, and that is because that will be where the sonic wave is going to arrive at the same time as the inertial motion. So it's actually just practically happening instantaneously. And the fluid actually has no idea what's happening over here because the waves are not arriving there fast enough. So they're traveling at the same time as the projectile is moving. So this part over here where the fluid has no idea what's happening is called the zone of silence. And that's just because the fluid has no idea or is unaware of what's happening before it. So fluid, unaware of moving projectile. And as a result, then the pressure wave cannot modify itself as it doesn't know what's happening beforehand. So, pressure wave unable to signal the not moving fluid. That the projectile is coming, so that projectile so what's happening, once we go into the supersonic, then it's going to know it's actually going to travel beyond this line, and then that's when we're going to start having our shockwaves happening. Because the pressure kind of like adjusts itself. Yeah, it's actually do something dramatic, which is the shockwave, which is going to change the properties of the fluid by changing the velocity and decreasing its velocity. So if we were to draw this, we have this four.
Would you mind going back to the very first example? Really explain each of those circles, like
it gets a little bit confusing, because let's say each of the circles, each 0, 1